Joining us in the studio this morning to clarify this issue, Justice Secretary Menardo Guevarra. Secretary, thank you so much for coming to the show. Thank you so much.
My pleasure, Karen.
All right. Good morning, the President said it seems to be a take-it-or-leave-it deal. There's a threat of a possible prosecution, the military taking over. What is the context? Do the concessionaires have a choice?
You know, the revised concession agreement that the government is preparing will remove all the provisions that are considered onerous or highly disadvantageous to the government and to the people. So I guess that is something that even the water concessionaires themselves will probably agree to. They know very well that these concession agreements were crafted and executed at a time when there were a lot of difficulties on the part of the MWSS. And the provisions there, many of the provisions there, were somehow, in a way, quote-unquote, imposed by the water concessionaires through their consultants and their lawyers. At that time, the Philippine government had not much exposure and experience in privatization. And so many of these provisions came into being. So this is the time that we're trying, times have changed, circumstances have changed. So this is the time that we're trying to remove those provisions to make the contract more equitable.
Okay. Secretary, this is right smack in the middle of the contract period. The International Arbitration Committees made a decision on Maynilad and Manila Water on what the government owes them, a total of 11 billion pesos. Can both concessionaires go to the Supreme Court? And do you believe that the Supreme Court won't overturn any action of the Philippine government?
On the matter of the awards granted by the Singapore Arbitration Tribunal, this is now an issue which is moot and academic. I'm saying that because the water concessionaires themselves have already waived under oath in writing these awards granted to them by the Singapore Arbitration.
So willingly?
Willingly, supported by the proper board resolution, they executed a release, waiver, and quit claim.
Okay. Right. Okay.
So that's a moot issue altogether. Yeah.
What about drafting a new agreement? Is the government prepared in case the Supreme Court overturns this?
I don't think this is also an issue because the water concessionaires themselves agreed to sit down with the government and renegotiate, review the contract. That came from them. So I suppose that they have voluntarily agreed, notwithstanding that this contract is already existing, to sit down and make certain amendments if necessary.
Okay. Now, we've often talked about the three onerous provisions. There's a lot of articles written extensively about it. But you've technically discovered 12 early on. Can we go through the 12 quickly?
All right. First, let me begin by repeating the major provisions which we believe are really onerous. And well, I have mentioned this in many statements before. The non-interference clause, which prohibits the government, the republic, from interfering in the rate-setting mechanism. Because as you know, this mechanism is purely between the regulatory office of the MWSS and the water concessionaire. The government has nothing to do with it. And the regulatory office is a mere creation of that contract. It's not a creation of the legislature, nor by an executive order on the part of the executive. All right, so there's an indemnity clause that that provides that in case the government interferes, and then because of that interference, the water concessionaire suffers any loss or damage, the government will have to indemnify this water concessionaire.
No. So, hence the award.
Hence the award.
Okay.
Yeah, fortunately, in a way.
Yeah, so two na yon.
All right, number three, the inclusion of certain business taxes, concession fees, debt service payments, even cost of appealing to the appeals panel, which is essentially an arbitration process, may be included as among the expenditures of the water concessionaire, and this can be passed on to the water consumer. So we find that very disadvantageous.
Yeah, yeah. Yes. And the Supreme Court made a decision against Meralco regarding something similar in the past.
Exactly.
So like that, you know, that's a cue
right.
already. All right, that's mm-hmm. three.
Another one is a reference to the concessionaire in the contract as a mere contractor of the MWSS. So because of that, under that contract, hindi parang binibigyan ng character of a public utility itong
yeah.
water concessionaire. And for that reason, they can argue that corporate income taxes can be considered as an expenditure and can be passed on to the consumer.
So will you, in the new contract, change that and define them as a public utility?
We'll make it very clear, at least to the extent that corporate income taxes definitely cannot okay. be made a factor in the setting of the water rates chargeable to the consumer.
Okay, so that's four.
Yes. There is preference given to the existing water concessionaire by the MWSS in the grant of license to provide water service in case there is a new development project.
Oh. Yeah, all like right, now, so. Yeah, there's you need a lot more projects,
right, so.
Kaliwa Dam, etc., additional water facilities.
That is not very clear, the definition
yeah.
of what a new development,
is.
Quote-unquote, is, but the oh. fact is mayroong preferential treatment being given to the water concessionaire under that agreement, that in case a third party may apply for a license to provide water service, then give preference to the existing water concessionaire.
And you'll remove that?
We propose
yeah.
to remove
okay.
that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so you can have a new player come in, and if they want to supply water or build a filtration system or build any other new project, they in other words, Maynilad and Manila Water will have real competition. The bidding starts all equally.
Right. That matter is something that is handled by the National Water Resources Board, MWRB, but it will seek the consent or approval of the MWSS. So that MWSS in turn assures that it will give its consent if the applicant will be one of the or the two concessionaires.
Okay, next. All is right. it the sixth or seventh?
I'm
okay, but go on,
fourth
sir.
In my list
yeah.
is the appointment of the concessionaire as an agent of the MWSS for the exercise of the power of eminent domain. That is expropriation.
Mm-hmm.
All right, we find that legally not acceptable because it's already a delegated power to the MWSS, the right to expropriate certain mm-hmm. property so that it may build infrastructures for the development and supply and distribution of water.
Uh-oh.
All right, so that power was delegated to the MWSS. But under this contract, MWSS further delegated that power to the water concessionaire.
Okay.
So
and why is that onerous for the government?
Well, you know, it's a derogation of
yeah.
Sovereign right, no, of eminent domain. You're giving it to a private party to determine what to expropriate and so forth and so on.
Yeah.
So that's a principle in law. A delegated power cannot be further delegated.
Okay. All right. Next.
There is also a provision that provides for an automatic acceptance by the MWSS regulatory office of any proposed standard water rates if the regulatory office does not act on that proposal within 30 days. So binibigyan lang ng 30 days yung regulatory office to accept yung proposed standard water rates. No? So we believe na parang medyo too tight yung 30 days. If the MWSS regulatory office does not act on that proposal, then it's deemed accepted. And deemed na assured na falling within the maximum allowable rates or something
yeah,
to that
okay.
effect. No? So parang automatic na confirmation
yeah.
within, you know, after 30
Uh-oh.
Days. Ito pa, this is also one highly questionable provision. In the event of termination of the agreement for cause attributable to the water concessionaire, the government shall be liable for the payment of a certain amount called the early termination amount. No? So note that default may come either from the side of the government or from the side of the water concessionaire. In either case, regardless of who caused the default, the government will have to pay something to the water concessionaire.
Mm-mm.
So that seems to be, for some lawyers, that's not acceptable. Mm-mm. Or if at all that the government has to pay the water concessionaire for its own default, hindi naman dapat ganyan kalaki ang babayaran.
Mm-mm. Okay.
Okay. So those are the more important.
But let's go with the 12, because I mean, these are what you've discovered early on, and most likely they'll be in the new draft.
Yes, the rest are not really onerous in the sense that they are highly objectionable.
Yeah.
But they appear to be needing some improvement.
Okay.
For example, we would like to inject provisions that would give the regulatory office more power.
Okay.
Because at present, it seems that much of the decision making is in the hands of the water concessionaire, and the regulatory office seems to be more on the consultative side only, or giving its consent. So we propose to make changes that would give the regulatory office more power.
Okay. Now, in terms of the contract itself, the reason that the government extended it to 2037 was the government needed more water projects, more capitalization, and now it's back to 2022. We are expecting more projects, more water sources. What would be the new formula? Because 25 to 30 years seems to be the international standard in, you know, the private sector taking over utilities for them to get the revenue back.
Well, that is something that should have been factored when the original concession agreement was executed. So they should have foreseen that. But at any rate, since we are now near the closing or termination date of the original concession agreement, which will be in 2022, then that is a matter that can be taken up in the renegotiation of this contract.
Are you open to an extension then if the water concessionaires say, Secretary, we agree to this, but would it be all right if we get our 2037? Because there's already money in the pipeline for these projects.
Exactly. So, you know, if it's a good contract, we want that to be an extended contract. If it's a bad contract, we want that to be terminated right away. So it all depends on what agreement, new agreement, the government and the water concessionaire will have. So if it's a good agreement that will benefit or redound to the benefit of the consuming public, then the government will be open to extend it beyond 2022.
Okay.
If it's good.
Okay.
But otherwise, if there is a stalemate or the water concessionaires insist on things that the government would not like, then we'll have to end it.
Under that contract, there's also a maximum. There's a cap of, I think, is it a 12% income, a profit cap? Will you change that? I mean, unless it's 12, if my memory serves me right, because I had my Maynilad on the show, and there's a cap for that.
Internal rate of return,
yes.
12%.
So are you still satisfied with that? Because what private companies do, they run companies more efficiently, so cost drops in within the company.
Well, that is something that we would rather have the Department of Finance examine. So as I have been telling some people, we don't exactly have the revised contract now. We only have that in our mind. We know what to remove, we know what to add. But there are certain aspects that we need inputs from, for example, the Department of Finance. On the financial and economic aspects, like what you said, a recomputation or re-evaluation of the agreed IRR, maximum cap, it's something that we may have to consult the Department of Finance. And the Department of Finance itself may consult with some experts on this matter. So we're awaiting all of these inputs before we come up with a consolidated draft that we can present to the water concessionaire.
Are you open to having another water concessionaire? a third party in the same region, because now you have east and west zone.
Right.
Uh-huh. But then because there are two, there's preference for the two, essentially, the contract is theirs. Mm-hmm. Are you recommending another opening?
No, for as long as these contracts subsist, they have exclusive right to the east zone and the west zone. Mm-hmm. Only when these contracts get terminated for some reason or another, that the government may open it to other players.
When the president uses words like the military will take over, nationalize the water system, you at one point said the government can't do it. A few weeks ago, you said the government isn't ready to do something like that.
Well, from a legal standpoint, the president or the government can do it because it's sanctioned. It's allowed by our constitution. Under Article 12, there are two sections that would allow that. Mm-hmm. One would be in a case of national emergency, when public interest requires, the government can temporarily take over the operation of a private business affected with public interest, like water distribution. All right, so there's no compensation there. Just a temporary takeover for the duration of the emergency.
But are we in a national emergency?
Well, that is a factual issue that has to be resolved. And the matter of who will run the operation of the water utilities in case that eventuality happens, the president mentioned the military. Of course, that is one option. But, it's something that has to be further threshed out. Who can operate this?
But it seems that the president really trusts you with this issue. I mean, you're the one speaking in authority when it comes to the new contract.
Well, it's simply because I was tasked to review the old contract. So necessarily, if we find something which is unacceptable in the old contract, naturally the next question will be, what do you suggest? What do you recommend?
Okay.
So I'm consulting other government agencies. It's not just the DOJ.
Okay. In terms of the MWSS, have they ever told you at least a few, you're asking the Department of Finance, but what about the MWSS for their recommendations?
They have their own inputs.
Okay.
And we are including them in the proposal.
Okay.
In the new proposed water concession.
All right. You've given a timetable of 6 months. So clearly within the 6 months, the concessionaires can raise rates, right?
Well, they have also agreed. And they have written to the president, and they have undertaken not to make or to impose any rate increases this start of the year.
Okay.
So that's one of the three undertakings that they made to the president.
Now, do you have a timetable of when the contract will be out? The longer it takes, of course, you have share prices dropping, projects suffering, because if you're Manila Water and Maynilad, you'll tend to hold off those projects until you feel secure with a new contract. And then we're affected with water generally.
Well, I guess in my own personal opinion, a period of 6 months would be enough to firm up everything, present it to the water concessionaires, and probably they can react already within that period.
Okay. The economy said it's like holding a gun to their head.
A gun will kill you. It's not something that we will offer to the water concessionaires. It's something that will give life.
Okay.
You know, life in the sense that it will be a better contract. You remove all illegal provisions. You put in terms that will be more equitable to the government and to the people. So that's a good contract. It's not something that will kill the water concessioners.
Okay. Now, moving on to another issue very quickly, is Vice President Leni Robredo came out with her report and her recommendations with the drug war. In that whole report, the Department of Justice's role essentially is the role of prosecution. Mm-hmm. Last 2019, at least the records I've read, is the DOJ's only prosecuted 76 related to the drug war. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't seem too impressive with the numbers mentioned on just how much drugs are in the country. Has the DOJ performed? I mean, how would you describe the DOJ's performance in terms of prosecution?
My own data would show a lot more. We're talking about hundreds of thousands of cases investigated and prosecuted by the DOJ. If we include cases that have reached the court, and where plea bargaining had been allowed, that would be considered a conviction. the success rate of the DOJ is something like 80%. If you include the plea bargaining cases where the accused would admit that they in fact committed something, but not the one charge, but something lower than that.
Okay.
So that would be considered a conviction. So if we include this plea bargaining cases, the conviction rate would be something like 80%.
Okay. Among the recommendations of the Vice President is also to allow AMLAC to directly prosecute drug-related money laundering offenses. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, I guess that's a good suggestion.
Okay.
AMLC.
Overall, how would you describe the recommendations of Vice President Robredo? I mean, not all pertain to the DOJ, of course, but overall, is there some basis to her recommendation at all?
Well, I have not read completely the report. I just know about the recommendations that she has made. For example, the change in the chairmanship of the ICAD, the Interagency Committee on Anti-Illegal Drugs. So many of them generally are all right, except that we need a lot of more, you know, more fleshing to the recommendations.
Okay.
So but in general, they're acceptable.
All right. Now with the case of Senator Laila de Lima, it's quite interesting because, of course, the Philippine government has imposed a ban too on three of the lawmakers who were the front runners and who supported and even authored this a prohibition entry addition in the 2020 U.S. budget. Now, you may want to clarify this. You have some international observers asking. You have former Senator Juan Ponce Enrile, who's out on bail for humanitarian reasons. You have no less than Senator Jingoy Estrada, accused of plunders, also out on bail. You may have some asking, then why not Senator Laila de Lima? This is why she's defined or described as a political prisoner, persecuted for being an oppositor of the president.
There is a simple answer to your question. Senator de Lima has not applied, has not filed any petition for bail. That's the simple answer to your question.
Yeah, because she's filed for dismissal. And,
yes,
yeah.
She has questioned many orders of the court, even her own indictment, which reached all the way to the Supreme Court.
Which they supported.
Which the petition was dismissed by the Supreme Court. But she has not applied for bail. So, you know, it's the offense committed is non-bailable. It's punishable by life imprisonment.
Yeah.
So automatically, that's non-bailable.
Yeah.
If you want, if you think that the evidence of the prosecution is weak, if you are the accused, you would probably consider filing a petition for a bail. But she has not done so.
So why do you think has she not done so?
She's the best person to answer that question.
Because it's quite interesting. Would it mean that because you have Jingo, plunder is also a non-bailable offense.
Yes.
And yet the Supreme Court, you do have the court granting it for Enrile, and
I can't really second guess why Senator de Lima has not done so. Maybe she believes that the evidence of the prosecution is strong.
Okay, so it came to a point that you even cursed when you heard about this. I won't repeat it on television, but you did curse and say this is already foreign intervention. And if they perceive me to be a part of this, then my conscience is clear. I'll live with that.
Exactly, that's what I said, you know, because this is interference with a legal and judicial process under our own laws. Why would you ask somebody who is still undergoing trial to be freed now?
All right. Well, on that note, I want to thank you so much, Justice Secretary Menardo Guevarra, for clarifying this and coming to the show. Thank you so much. My